outside St Thomas's Hospital, which is opposite the Houses of Parliament. And I'm here to introduce you to a really, really special person who is a British Jamaican. She was born in 1805. She's most famous for her nursing. There's lots of staff, they're all going on shift. And it reminds me of how, you know, we've kept the NHS really close to our hearts. Loads of you did the rainbow pictures and put them on the windows of your home. And Mary Seacole, she put her life on the line, and her hospital was in a place called Balaclava in the Crimea, and it was called the British Hotel, and it was right on the front line. Mary Seacole's ambition and drive and bravery, it might have got lost in history if it wasn't for a group of nurses that came from the Caribbean. And they came from the Caribbean just after the millennium, and they went to Mary Seacole's grave in North London to commemorate her. And I think they were thinking to themselves, you know, why isn't this person celebrated? Because we celebrate people like Florence Nightingale, who set up a hospital in the Crimea, but we haven't really heard of Mary Seacole. And so they wrote to their MP, and their MP started a campaign to get this statue erected. Mary Seacole's nursing started way before the Crimea, because in Jamaica, in Kingston, Jamaica, where Mary was brought up, there was a terrible outbreak of cholera and yellow fever. You might remember cholera when we did Victorians, the Thames, and the big stink, yeah? And she nursed her local community using fantastic Jamaican medicine. And she did things like she used cinnamon bark to make medicines. And she used things like guava and these exotic ingredients to make people feel better. So I'm up here in a really windy park, and it reminds me of Misselthwaite Manor and the secret garden. Remember Francis Hodgson Burnett's book? And this behind me, it looks a bit like the secret garden with a curtain of ivy behind it. And you're doing plants this week. Here are some meadow flowers, and these are perennials. If these are cut down each year, they'll grow back again next year. They're hugely important for insects, for pollinators like bees and butterflies as well. And you can see they've got a range of poppies and blue cornflower and daisies, and there's some marigolds over the other side. And normally you would plant them in amongst grasses. And you might not know that grasses are flower, and you have to be quite vigilant if you want to spot flowers on grass. There are some developing here.
I've got a plastic bag, and I'm just going to tie it around some leaves on this tree. I wonder whether you can think back to what we were thinking about last week with the water cycle, and think about why I might be tying a plastic bag around the leaves of a tree.
I've tied my bag around my tree, and it's a nice, it's a warm day, and there isn't very much wind. And I'm also waiting for the sun to come out and shine on this bag. And then I'm going to see if you can guess what is going to happen. Transpiration is what plants use as part of the evaporation process. And transpiration is how water moves around a plant.
Well, just having a look at the bag to see if any transpiration has taken place.
So this has been successful. My tree has been nicely transpiring and contributing to the water cycle. And I think over the next couple of weeks you'll be learning about how water is transported around plants and trees. And so vascular plants are plants that can transport water, and non-vascular plants are things that don't have roots and can't transport water through their roots and up their stems. And non-vascular plants are things like mosses and alga and stuff like that.
There you go, transpiration in process. Got quite a bit of water in there, and as you can see, no tree has been harmed. The leaves are still on there, still ready to photosynthesize. Sometimes trees are chopped down to supply us with things like wood and paper. But it's really important that we keep thinking and bearing in mind the delicate balance in the relationship we have with trees, because we use things from them, but they provide us with really important stuff like oxygen. And they do that through photosynthesis. And photosynthesis is a Greek word. Photo means light, and synthesis means putting together. And basically what trees do, they use the sunlight, they use the energy from the sun with carbon dioxide and water to make oxygen. And that's what we breathe in. And then they remove the carbon dioxide that we breathe out. But it's not just the tree's job to make nice oxygen for us. The main point of photosynthesis is for trees to make food for themselves. And you can see the lovely green colours of these leaves. And that green colour comes from something called chlorophyll. And chlorophyll is a pigment. And chlorophyll and also chloroplasts are the things that store the energy from the sun in the leaves.
So we've talked a bit about how plants, they make their own energy through photosynthesis and the power of their leaves in that process. And so what I've done is I went on a little walk around the garden and I've collected up some leaves that have just fallen off trees and plants. And I'm going to make a little artwork to celebrate photosynthesis.
Starry, starry night, paint your palette blue and grey. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills, sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chills in colours on the
snow. This is fabulous down here by the barrier. I'm thinking about the power of plants. There we've got lots of algae that is growing all over the rocks. And then down here, you might be able to see, just down here, there's some yellowy, greeny stuff that's clinging onto the rocks. And that is lichen. And lichen is a reaction between algae and fungi. Lichen is wonderful. Look, you can see here, just on the railing, and you might have seen lichen on things like trees as well. You might remember when we went over to the Pleasance, we did a little field trip when we did classification of plants. And we lifted up some logs and things, and we found quite a bit of fungi underneath. And we also saw some of this stuff, lichen, on the trees. So if you're out and about today, see if you can spot some lichen and think about where it's growing and why it might be growing there.
So lichen's not a plant, but it's interesting because it uses algae, which is a plant, and fungi in order to exist.
So the fungi has made friends with the algae and they're using each other, okay, to grow. It's teeming with life and plants down here. And that started me thinking about the early earth and how plants started to grow in the first place.
And the early earth would have been a very brown, kind of smudgy place. And a completely different chemical atmosphere to what we've got now.
And plants had a massive role to play in that, and particularly algae. Algae is so important because about 650 million years ago, there was an explosion of algae on the early Earth. And if that hadn't happened, we wouldn't be here, because algae allowed us to come from the sea and then evolve onto land. It's teeming with algae down here, and it is growing over everything, even this old chain. And it's truly fascinating how an organism, a thing like algae and moss and liverwort, how that can take over something without having any roots or having a support like a stem. Because that's what vascular plants have got. They have roots. You know, they've got roots that go down into the ground, and then they've got a stem, and how they transport water. And it's amazing that, you know, these things that are a little bit like seaweed, mushy things, that they can dominate so much. This is a great example, okay, of vascular plants. And really, really early examples of plants that photosynthesize. The grasses have got roots that go into the ground, and they've really got tall stems. And look, and they've got lots of leaves, so the sun can shine on the leaves, and it's got lots of chlorophyll in the leaves, which is the stuff that makes it green. So it can definitely photosynthesize. But this creature over here, it hasn't got any roots, it doesn't have leaves, it hasn't got a stem to reach up. And this tree behind me, this tree was around in Chile over 200 million years ago, during the Jurassic era. So dinosaurs such as Diplodocus would have been around then. And yeah, these trees, they become known as monkey puzzle trees because there was a famous Victorian who, I think he purchased one for about, it was £25 I think he paid, which is £3,000 in today's money. And he bought one of these monkey puzzle trees from Chile, and he called it a monkey puzzle tree because he thought it would be a puzzle for monkeys to climb. And it really is quite different. It has little pine cones and things, and not leaves like deciduous trees. This is quite a different character altogether. Yeah, and the evolution of bark, which is part of the story of plants. So bark was possible due to a really special polymer, and it was called lignin. And lignin is really important for trees. We wouldn't have trees unless there had been lignin. And so when you're looking around at trees and looking at the bark and the different shapes of bark, you can say a little thank you to lignin for that. The trunk of that tree is absolutely massive. It's over a meter wide. And I don't know whether you know, but this huge noble giant, I bet it's got some stories to tell, but I'm sure that you know that you can work out the age of a tree by counting its rings. Yeah, trees have definitely taken their place as characters in books. One really well-known one is called Treebeard, and he turns up in Lord of the Rings. Ferns are one of the oldest plants on Earth, and they are a vascular plant, really, really important plant, and I think they date back 380 or 400 million years ago. And right by these ferns, I found some excellent examples of moss, okay? So, yeah. So you see down here on these little stumps, yeah, there's lots of moss, so yeah. And moss is a non-vascular plant because it doesn't have stems, okay? And it hasn't got roots, okay? It gets its moisture, it gets its water in other ways. Now, there are also some lovely leaves that have fallen off trees, okay, down here. They're a beautiful golden colour. And you might remember from Key Stage 1, you learnt about deciduous trees, you know, trees whose leaves fall off in the autumn. And I was wondering, you know, in our kind of story and evolution of plants, I was wondering about what the first deciduous tree might have looked like. And I've done a bit of research and I found out. But apparently it would have been a cross between a kind of conifer and also a fern. And this tree, it's an evergreen and it's a eucalyptus tree. Eucalyptus is used in quite a few remedies and home cures and oils. It sheds its bark. And you know, I've told you about bark and lignin. That's what makes trees and plants stand up. Because it gives the cell walls extra strength.
And one of the great things about Mary Seacole is that she realised that you could use plants and products from plants in order to make medicines and little tinctures. And she used cinnamon bark as one of the things. She used to boil it up, and also guava. And these are really exotic products from plants from Jamaica.
So over the term, you have done several investigations and experiments, and we have been blown away by your scientific knowledge and your scientific method. Now today, we're going to look a little bit at variables. And to tell you a bit about this, I want you to think about the questions you might ask. And you know, we're learning about plants this week. And so you might have a question, like something like, do plants need sun and water in order to grow? Now, that's a great question, but it's a bit confusing because you've got two things in there that you might be measuring, because you asked a question about sun and you also asked a question about water. Now, so it's really important you think of a good question, all right? So I've thought of a good question, and my question is, do plants need soil to grow? All right. Now, I know you've done a bit about germination before when you're in year one and two. I think you did cress seeds and things like that. So you know about germination. So when water goes on the seed, there's a reaction and the sprouts come out. And I think you've watched that when you did your cress. Now, I've got some things here and I'm really going to think about my variables, the things that I can't control, and I'm going to make sure that I do control them, okay? And I'm only going to make sure that I change one of the variables. And the variable that I'm going to change is basically the thing that I put the seed in. So here I've got some sand, I've got some soil, I've got some paper towel, and I've got some cotton wool, and I've also got nothing at all right? And I've labelled my cups. If you've got plastic cups, you could do them in plastic cups, but I just, you know, I like an espresso and I've just got these left over so you can reuse things. But I am keeping them the same, yeah, because I've got to control my variables, all right? I'm only going to change one thing. And the other thing that I'm going to do, I've got my cotton wool in here. I'm going to make sure that I've got the same amount of stuff in each of my little cups, and I think that's the cotton wool one. So I put the cotton wool in there, and basically I measured it in here. So when I do the paper towel, I'm going to make sure I've got the same amount of paper towel. So I'm going to pop it in there like that. Oh no, I need a little bit more to make it fair, make the test fair. So I'm putting it in there. There, you think you can see it there. Yeah, that's about the same. Right, so that's paper towel. Really important that you actually label your pots like a proper scientist, because you're all proper scientists at home. You've proved that really well this term. Let's put it down like that. So that's exactly the same amount. And as you can see, I'm going to do exactly the same with my soil. And remember to tidy up after yourselves, yeah? You know, like parents and tables, they like a nice clean table. There we go. Actually, I'm going to use my hands to get that. I'm going to put that in there. Make sure it's exactly the same amount, because I want to control those variables. I only want to change one thing. Because remember, my question is, do plants need soil to grow? Right. And while you're doing this, you might want to think about all the biomes we've done. Yeah, that's level, being very scientific here. You might want to think about all the biomes and different habitats we've done and living things. and just the things that you've seen around, you know. Do you think that you might come across different plants in different places, like deserts and tundra and stuff like that? Oh dear, nearly made a mistake. That was a good mistake though. I nearly put the sand in without measuring it. That's a good mistake. Right, put that in there. My sand in. And there we go, that's going to be the same amount. Checking all the time. Right, there we go. Okay, now you can use any seeds. I would recommend you use a seed that will germinate quickly, and I've got radish seeds, and these are a pound. These, you can buy these on the internet for a pound. Don't need expensive seeds, but what you do need your seeds to be is really fresh. If you've got old seeds that have been knocking about, you know, a shed somewhere or a cupboard for a couple of years, they're probably not going to be very good. And then you want to put in two seeds, and it's kind of like you want to put two seeds in case one of them fails, all right? But make sure you only put two seeds in. And this cup, I haven't got anything in, okay? So put my seeds in, one in there. And I tend to go along quite methodically, okay? So one in there, one in there. One in there, and then go back. It's very important when you're doing these testing, this experiment, that you do everything the same so you really control those variables. You're only going to change one thing. Right. Okay, and now, I need to use water, and I'm not just going to pour it in from here. I've got a special little thing to measure, and I've decided that I'm going to make sure that I'm going to fill this up, and it's going to be level for each pot. All right. Oh, bubbles. Yeah, and I'm really going to check it. Yeah, that's level. Right, so I'm going to add that there. And I've just, while I'm doing this, I've just remembered a key thing that I've forgotten. So in a minute, I'm going to dash off to the kitchen to get my cling film. Although I might have a little helper that's just heard me. Oh, forgot that. Yeah, right, okay. Yeah, I did have a little helper. Right, okay, thank you. Magic person just came and gave me some cling film with an invisible person. And I also need the invisible person. Could you get me something really pointy, like a little cocktail stick or something that I can make holes in this? You probably think I've got a ghost working here. Right, okay. So I've got some cling film. And what you want to do is, now I've got all of that, it's all watered in the pots. I've got two seeds per pot. Yeah, two, just in case one of them fails. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put, thank you, invisible person. And this is a cocktail stick to make holes in, because remember, I want to do everything exactly the same. I'm going to put a bit of cling film over the top. Okay, like this. And I'm not going to do it for every single one, because you will be bored out your brains watching me do this. I'm going to put this over there like that, exactly the same for each one. And because, you know, proper scientists, and I'm going to put just four little pinprick holes. And then you want to pop them just on a nice sunny window ledge and wait to see what happens. And do make a prediction. And also remember to water them every couple of days, and remember to water them by the same amount. So huge round of applause to you people. Keep your rainbows really close to your hearts. We've had people just taking care of us, and everyone's been looking out for one another. We really want to thank you from House Stove for supporting us so much over these last few weeks. Really, the future is definitely bright.
And over the coming weeks and months, we're going to gradually crawl out of this. But please, let's always look out for each other.